PolarTREC is a National Science Foundation program that pairs K-12 science teachers with researchers working in the polar regions. As a PolarTREC teacher, I traveled from my home in Colorado to the Tulik Research Station in Alaska. Here, I joined a team of researchers led by Dr. Cory Williams of the University of Alaska at Anchorage. Cory's research centers on the understanding of circadian rhythms in the Arctic ground squirrel. Our study site is located along the Adigan River at the base of the Brooks Mountain Range, adjacent to the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. As spring arrives to the Arctic tundra, the ground squirrels are active, consuming as many calories as possible during the short summer. This female likely has a litter of several pups and is actively feeding on the new buds of these dwarf birch trees. The Arctic ground squirrel is supremely adapted to the extreme environment of the Arctic. To cope with the cold of winter, these animals hibernate up to 9 months of the year, longer than any other mammal. They are also able to cool their body temperature to a point nearly 3 degrees below freezing, another record for mammals. In the following segment, Dr. Cory Williams will explain his current research project.
My interests are really broad. I'm interested in sort of adaptations to extreme environments. So I think the Arctic ground squirrel is a really interesting model for how they survive in the Arctic environment. They face a very short active season where it's light for 24 hours a day. So this is really interesting from the perspective of circadian clocks. They're also really interesting because they spend 8 to 9 months of the year in hibernation. And so we're also interested in understanding what happens to circadian clocks during hibernation. Arctic ground squirrels are particularly interesting in terms of studying their circadian rhythms because a lot of other Arctic species effectively become arrhythmic during the Arctic summer. So ptarmigan and reindeer on Svalbard Island in Norway will become arrhythmic in their Arctic summer. So the questions we have are, what is the function of maintaining circadian rhythms in an environment that never becomes dark? And what are the cues these animals use to keep their rhythms entrained in the natural environment in the absence of a light-dark cycle? Despite the fact that it's constantly light during the Arctic summer, squirrels don't emerge from the burrow until sort of after 9 a.m. And then they're active throughout the day, but they're back in their burrows typically by 7 p.m., although occasionally you'll see squirrels out as late as 10 p.m. Mm-hmm. But you never see them in the middle of the night, even though the night's not dark. During the Arctic summer. We're interested in understanding why, if they have the opportunity to forage throughout the day because it's constantly light, do they restrict their activity to only that midday interval? And we suspect that this is driven by energetic considerations. Because even though it's constantly light, there are still some fluctuations in light intensity. But there's also fluctuations in temperature. And it's only during this midday interval that it's warm enough to be within the thermoneutral zone for these squirrels. Mm-hmm. So if they're active at other times of day, then they would have to expend more energy while they're foraging. Okay. So one of our major activities throughout the summer is trapping squirrels. Implanting them with body temperature loggers and deploying light collars on squirrels. And these light collars provide us information on when they're above ground and when they're below ground. And the body temperature provides us information on the circadian body temperature rhythms that they have.
Each of these live traps is baited with fresh carrots and placed outside of the burrow.
Humans maintain a constant temperature all the time, and if it varies, then it's an indication that you're sick. But that's not true with the Arctic ground squirrels. Their body temperatures change.
So, in fact, all mammals maintain slight fluctuations in body temperature, And one of the roles that this fluctuation in body temperature has is to entrain peripheral circadian clocks throughout the body. So we have a master circadian clock in our brain within the suprachiasmatic nuclei, or the SCN. And this master clock entrains clocks found throughout the body. Now, when you get into smaller mammals, rodents such as squirrels, those fluctuations in body temperature are larger. It's about a degree and a half fluctuation throughout the day. And so they're slightly warmer when they're in their active phase and slightly cooler when they're in their inactive phase. Right, so what we typically see in Arctic ground squirrels is that during the parts of the day where they're more active, they're slightly warmer. But when you get bad weather conditions, such as snowfall events, they'll remain below ground, but you'll still see this circadian rhythm of body temperature. Mm-hmm. So they'll become warmer during the day, even though they're not active on the surface. Mm-hmm. And so the other thing these activity loggers give us, or these light loggers give us, is a good indication of how weather affects their activity patterns. We're conducting what we call a phase shift experiment, where we're bringing squirrels into captivity for a short period of time, about 15 days, and we're shifting their circadian clock by 12 hours. So we have a control group that will be maintained on a normal circadian rhythm, and then we'll shift the experimental group by an hour a day for 12 days, and then maintain them on that new circadian rhythm for another 3 days before releasing them. And so this will give us an indication after we release them of what happens when a squirrel is completely out of phase with their natural environment. How rapidly can they re-entrain in the absence of a light-dark cycle? And what are the energetic consequences of being out of phase with the natural environment? And so we're measuring energy using the doubly labeled water approach, which gives us an indication of their daily metabolic rate following release. Essentially, what we're doing is giving these squirrels, you know, a fairly large degree of jet lag, and it takes time to shift that circadian clock. And so that's, you know, one difficult aspect of the experiment and why we have to hold them as long as we do prior to releasing them. Mm-hmm. If you took a human and phase shifted them and released them in the Arctic environment, they would have a large degree of difficulty re-entraining their clocks if they didn't have external clocks on the wall that they use to keep their rhythms entrained. So we do this behaviorally, and we self-impose a dark schedule on ourselves when we're in the Arctic environment because we know what time of day it is. But how does a small mammal like an Arctic ground squirrel know what time of day it is if it's always light?
There you go.
We usually bait the traps with a couple of easily accessible carrots out in front. Then the squirrel has to go inside to get the rest. But not this guy, he's figured out a better way.
What's going on? Some squirrels took all the carrots. Crafty little dude.
Nice things about working with the Arctic ground squirrels is they really don't like bad weather. And so when it's bad weather out, we don't have to go out to trap them because we can't catch them. So we're kind of softies when it comes to field research in the Arctic.
Oh, this guy can't resist those carrots. Oh, gotcha! Once the squirrels are caught, we take them back to the truck, anesthetize them, and then download the light collars. Once the squirrels are processed, we return them to the exact same burrow where we caught them. They're pretty cute. Well, we're holding them until they wake up.
So we know that in humans, disruption of circadian rhythms has a variety of negative health consequences. So it's interesting to us that you have this other mammal that is capable of maintaining and trained circadian rhythms in an environment that lacks really robust entrainment cues. So most of the work that takes place on rodent models for understanding circadian rhythms involves nocturnal animals, mice and rats. But here we have another diurnal species that has a very robust circadian system. Yeah. So in terms of humans, disruption of circadian clocks has a variety of these negative health consequences, such as cardiovascular disease. So for example, in shift workers, you see that they often have elevated levels of cardiovascular disease, and this is thought to be associated with disruption of clocks. But at the moment, we don't understand what the mechanisms or what the associations are between disruption of circadian rhythms and these types of diseases. Mm-hmm. So circadian clocks are found in all organisms, whether you're a unicellular organism or a multicellular organism, plants, animals, they all have these circadian clocks. Now, in the case of mammals, it's known that we have circadian clocks throughout our bodies. You have one master clock that's located in the brain, and this is the clock that's entrained to the light-dark environment. This master clock entrains peripheral clocks that are found throughout the body using a variety of signals, including hormones, but also these changes in body temperature that occur throughout the day. Mm-hmm. These peripheral clocks can also be entrained to other cues, such as feeding. So if you feed an animal at a certain time of day, some of these peripheral clocks will become entrained to that feeding cue. Mm-hmm.